And the doctor, you know, who I did a blood test, and the first thing he said, oh, it's, you know, it's in the clouds. He said, you're going to have to be on statins for the rest of your life. And that was the first thing he said to me, you know, and it's just like, really? You know, honestly, you can't even give me some advice.
Craig, how did you find carnivore?
Right. Yeah, hi Dave. Yeah, well, I mean, a kind of succinct version of it, I suppose, is that I stumbled across Michaela Peterson. I was just blown away by her, really. I think that just seeing someone's testimony, just giving her kind of heartfelt testimony of her life, really, and how she really battled through so much diversity and, you know, to get to find that kind of the solutions herself, really. It was really amazing to story for me to see, and it just kind of rang really true with me. Not that I've had anything as far as, you know, severity that she's had, but it just started me down the road of like, yeah, I've always been a bit alternative anyway, of looking for the alternative mindset rather than just the mainstream. And yeah, just thinking, wow, it seems so kind of commonsensical, really, when you've got somebody like that who's been forced into, you know, complete adversity to try and heal herself and finding something that did really help. And it was so kind of simplistic in a way, you know, really, really rang true with me in that sense. And I've always had problems with food. Always had problems with food. I remember when my mother used to feed me. Do you remember Findus? Findus Foods, all the old frozen stuff from the 1970s. She used to feed me Findus crispy pancakes, and I would say to her, "Oh, Mum, I just don't. What's wrong with those? They'd wipe me out. My energy would go. I'd have bad stomach pains. I'd get headaches." And I feel awful. And that was from when I was really young, you know, at junior school. And I've always just been really sensitive to certain foods. And with that, and actually now knowing my whole family has, because we've just been known as like trumpeters, you know, we'd like eat anything, would be the whole family would be trumpeting away in the living room, you know, and it was like we'd all be bloated, trumpeting. Family together watching the generation game or whatever. It was a nightmare. So, and you know, having read a lot about, you know, food over the years, and you know, that's my body. I realized that's my body reacting, you know, negatively to a lot of foods. And then kind of, you know, in fact, I just lived with it for many years that really didn't notice it, sort of. I just went along and lived with it and being, you know, having a lot of wind all the time and certain times it would be quite debilitating where I couldn't sleep at night, things like that, you know, it was like really, really kind of bad. And certain times, you know, where the smell is so disgusting, you know, it's like really bad. It's you know, looking back on it now, I just think it's so obviously, you know, the body is just completely rejecting, you know, what I'm eating. And then I moved to Spain, probably about 18 years ago now, and it kind of kick-started a bit of a healthy, more of a healthy living, healthy life, really. And what was interesting was, I mean, I'm you know, I born kind of, I grew up around the London area. Kind of just on the north edge of London, and you know, I'm a baby boomer, so I was born in 67, and you know, coming to my kind of 80s and 90s and going out and being, you know, typical Brit, really, you know. And then I came to Spain kind of 18 years ago, and I had a Spanish girlfriend at the time, and just the culture change was quite an interesting time for me, and I just started drinking water. You know, it's like, as bad as it may seem, you know, you know, us typical Brits go out drinking pints, you know, you go and meet your friends and it's pints all the time. And I came to Spain, I started drinking water, and all of a sudden I started getting these pains down the left-hand side of my neck, down my shoulder. And I went to see what they're called now. A specialist guy who just kind of, he did tests with the saliva and the urine and the blood, and he just tested the whole body. And he said, well, it's your liver cleaning itself out. You know, it's just like all of a sudden you're living a bit of a cleaner life. And so that took kind of about 6 months. And every time I'd go swimming, I'd get this pain down here. It was really debilitating. And then it was just all the problems started from then, really, when I started to live a much kind of cleaner lifestyle. So I was drinking less, and I was eating a bit healthier, you know, in regards to the kind of the westernized diet. But then everything, you know, what's interesting for me is after trying to, you know, kind of realize, okay, I'm drinking less alcohol, I'm eating a little bit healthier, eating more vegetables and fruit, and of course Spain, where I am in Valencia, I mean the fruit and vegetables are amazing, you know, Valencian oranges, and you know the Valencian tomatoes are just unbelievably beautiful. When I eat tomatoes like they are, you know, the fruit that they are, they're so sweet. But that started the ball rolling, really. Of then I started having really bad stomach issues, really, you know, that's when it all kind of resurfaced again, and just kind of constant diarrhea all the time, you know, just couldn't get rid of the diarrhea, and had really bad candida overgrowth, and just lots of. And then when I kind of hit, I mean, I'm 56 now, coming up to 57, my daughter was born when I was 40. Just after that, really, a couple of years after that, my metabolism just seemed to change completely, and I just put on weight so easily, even though I was drinking much less. And yeah, everything kind of all of a sudden just really bloated all the time, just really bad digestive system, putting on loads of weight. And I started then getting into fasting. So I was really interested in, you know, the fasting world, and watching a few YouTubers doing that. And I started off with a 36-hour fast, then a kind of month later did a three-day one. And, you know, I got over a couple of years, I really lost a lot of weight. Not that I was massive. I've always been kind of sporty, used to play football a lot, and always been interested in keeping fit and going down the gym and generally, you know, in that sense. But just weight was just starting to pile on. And then, yeah, like I say, the stomach trouble's really coming back with a vengeance. And certain foods, I'd start swelling up. So my fingers would start, you know, getting inflamed, and my ankles and my toes. And, you know, and I could drink like certain drinks, like certain beers would just make me really inflamed and puff up and things like that. So that really fueled kind of like the looking for the alternative side of what's out there. Because I'm, you know what it's like. You go to the doctors and they just, all they think about is drugs, isn't it? It's like they just want to prescribe you drugs. And I'm much more of a holistic kind of looking side of things. I'd much rather look on the natural side. If there's a natural alternative, then, you know, why not? You know, have a look for that. But everything I know about going to a, you know, a GP practitioner is always just, you know, have this drug. I mean, I went to see years ago, my father has high blood pressure and cholesterol, you know, and I remember mine was getting a little bit higher, and my cholesterol was, and my blood pressure is generally a bit high. And the doctor, you know, who I did a blood test, and the first thing he said, oh, it's, you know, it's in the clouds. He said, you're going to have to be on statins for the rest of your life. And that was the first thing he said to me, you know, and it's just like, really? You know, honestly, you can't even give me some advice to, you know. So I'm very skeptical, you know, as far as doctors are concerned. And in Spain, even more so, because I'd say the health system here is probably more indoctrinated to the whole the pharmaceutical system really is. I've had to change my doctor like 4 times since I've been here. So once I saw Michaela Peterson, she really kind of opened my eyes to it, and I just thought she was amazing. And you know, such a brave young woman at the time doing what she did. And then I just kind of through the paths, isn't it? Kind of like the algorithm and so everything on YouTube and going down that kind of rabbit hole. That, yeah, I kind of learned more, a little bit more about, you know, carnivore and, you know, finding all the different people that there are. And low carb, you know, low carb down under. I really got into them and just, you know, going down the keto way. And I started doing keto first and really going low carb. And it's quite, you know, it's quite a time of experimentation, isn't it, really, of trying new things. And it takes quite a while to kind of wrap your head around it, really, and get in the groove and find what kind of works for you, you know. And, you know, it's one of the things, especially with my electrolytes now. I mean, I've been into the full-on live diet for just coming up to 2 months solid now. So, and I've done keto off and on for the last kind of 3 years, really, maybe 3.5 years. And probably for me, the electrolytes is one of the areas. It's a little bit, I'm trying to find the right balance with the electrolytes, you know. So, and I'm still a little bit trying to find the right balance, you know, 2 months in on a live diet. I know if I have too much salt, it's almost like my arteries just seize up kind of thing. And I really feel as if I'm having too much salt. So I have to be careful with that. But yeah, I mean, I get, you know, the cramps a little bit.
So, 2 months into Lion,
yeah.
How have things changed for you? Especially, I'm interested in what's changed between keto and Lion as far as how you feel. Or
yeah, I mean, massive difference between keto and Lion for me. I mean, keto was kind of good, but one thing for me, definitely, I've always struggled a little bit on the depression side. So that's always been a little bit kind of, so my mood, but much, much, much better on the carnivore, without a doubt, you know, just feeling generally much more alive. And but I can, but I'm, this is one of the areas for me, I'm super, super sensitive to sugar that can, like, I can be up one moment and then I'm super, super down. If I'm having too much sugar for too long, and something that is, you know, really kicks me over the edge, I could be really down for quite a few weeks, you know, and I know it's sugar related for me. So with the keto, it's a little bit, I found it a little bit more complex, and my mood was better, but wasn't as good as it is now that I'm on carnivore, without a doubt, you know. But I felt much, much better. I felt lighter in general, with my energies being really good. Balancing a little bit of the electrolytes. Some days I have a little bit less energy than others. When I first started with the Lion, then I didn't think I was having enough fat. So I've been supplementing some kind of beef dripping, and managed to find a really good butcher, actually, who's been supplying me with fresh suet, which is really good. How have you found kind of that balancing of electrolytes and really. Have you had to do much balancing with that yourself?
I haven't found so much of an issue there. I had cramps occasionally, but that's just a signal that I haven't had enough salt.
Yeah.
And recently I've been eating so much salt that, yeah, I don't get cramps anymore.
Yeah, okay. Yeah, I mean, one thing I found initially was really dehydration. So that first month I felt really dehydrated a lot. Interestingly enough, my first month went really, really super well. You know, had like probably 10 days of the diarrhea of that. I know one of the areas that when I saw the specialist, that I know I don't produce enough digestive enzymes, but mostly for carbohydrates, actually. I can't remember which ones those are for carbohydrates, but I mean, it was another reason that kind of pushed me much towards doing the Lyme diet, because the specialist said, well, you need to take digestive enzymes and some betaine, I think it is, because I'm not producing the enzymes to break carbohydrates down. So I was like, well, what's the point in eating the carbohydrates then? If I'm not producing those enzymes, I'll just cut them out. You know, it makes more sense that way. But I've still been taking those. But the first month was just pretty easy, you know, a little bit of diarrhea and that, and running to the toilet a couple of times, you know, not being able to fart with confidence, you know. But the second month has been more of a challenge. Definitely been more of a challenge, I would say. Just balancing those kind of the salt and getting that right. And yeah, a few times my sleep generally has been pretty good, but I do occasionally wake up after about an hour and a half and just like as if I've slept a whole night. You know, I might go to bed at 10 o'clock, 12 o'clock, and I wake up bright as a button, and it's 1:30, and I think, all right, okay. So, but I'll go back to sleep pretty quickly, not too bad. But in general, my sleep is pretty good, I must admit. So I'm pretty pleased with that. The only, you know, I think in some respects, I mean, I had all of my family here this weekend, pretty much, barring my mother and my other brother. You know, I had like 12 members of my family come and visit this weekend. And it's hard, you know, when you're the only one, isn't it? Like, we all went out. I went out to a tapas restaurant, and actually I had to take my own food because they didn't have anything really that I could eat, you know. Well, they didn't have any beef on the menu, so I had to take my own food. So, and it was a little bit, you know, I feel a little bit kind of singled out. When you're with kind of lots of people, but I'm not too worried about that.
How are you eating at the moment? Like, how many times a day, and what is it made up of?
Yeah, twice a day, kind of more or less now. I started off kind of three times a day, and it's gone down to twice, just kind of naturally. I've got a really good butcher, the local market, a really lovely, friendly Colombian guy. And so I just go to him and get whatever decent cuts of beef there are at the moment. Really, I'm only having beef. I've been having a little bit of liver about once a week. And I haven't had any, since I've been doing the live diet, I haven't had any other organs, but I kind of introduced them back into my diet. I mean, I hated liver, kidneys, and, you know, for all my life. But, you know, I kind of reintroduced them. You know, they go down okay now. A little bit of heart sometimes have done. So, but I don't have them too often, like, so maybe once a week, once every 2 weeks. I just really try and find some nice, good, cheap cuts of beef. And then, of course, the go-to is minced meat, isn't it, really? I think, you know, I go to my local butcher. Looking at all the meat in the supermarkets, especially something like minced beef, I mean, here in Spain, it's only like 90% minced beef. I mean, there's like they have rice flour in there, and you know, there's so many other ingredients that you know you have to be really careful of. So yeah, essentially that's it. I have steak in the morning, then so a nice bit of steak, maybe about 11 o'clock, when I think I need to have a bit of food, because you know what it's like. You don't get really ravenous hungry, you know, do we? So and I got given like 5 kilos of suet, so I cooked that all down and made beef dripping out of it, and so I've got massive stash of some, you know, really good tallow. So I just have a nice bit of that with my beef every time to give me the extra fat, because I kind of read like 200 grams of fat is kind of really the minimum, isn't it? Right, to keep you going. And I was originally having a bit more protein than I am now, and my, especially when I was having 3 meals a day, but now I'm on 2. My protein, I don't measure my protein or anything like that, but it just kind of naturally felt as if I was having a little bit too much, having 3 a day, and now I kind of dropped down to 2. It feels really comfortable, and I feel good with it, and just make sure I have a nice dolloping of fat with it, and yeah, that's it at the moment. You know, few people have said, you know, God, don't you get bored? And I don't think I'll ever get bored of a juicy steak ever in my life. You know, maybe the minced beef. I've had a couple of evenings, and the one thing I do find with minced beef, the fresher it is, the much better it tastes. If you know, if I might buy a kilo and I've left it 5 days till I've got to the end of it, you know, the last kind of nice chunk of it that I cook up is not always as tasty. For some reason, the freshness really counts on them at minced beef, I would say. And cooking it so it's still a little bit red and pink in the middle. If you cook minced beef a bit too much, it becomes a little bit too, you know, it's a bit dry, doesn't it, minced beef? So, yeah, keep it juicy. That's my motto. So, it's good.
Nice. Right? So you mentioned your daughter and your girlfriend. Like, how have they reacted to this?
Yeah, it's interesting, actually. I mean, my daughter's 16, soon to be 17. She's in her own little teenage world. She doesn't really talk too much about it, actually, because she still wants her pizza and, you know, her burger and chips and things like that. So I'm not forcing that upon her at all. She's always known me as being sort of trying a little bit alternative things. So it's something that she's quite sort of used to in a way. My girlfriend, she's a true, she's from more northern Spain than where we live in Valencia, and true Spanish meat eating country, actually. So she was funny because I came back from England at Christmas time. My daughter and I always go back to England, see the family. You know, we really love spending time with the family back in England. And I was like, so I'd started, so I was doing keto up until to January. So I was being a little bit loose while I was in England this last Christmas. And then when I came back, I met up with my girlfriend. So she stayed here and seeing her family. And we came back and we had a nice walk down the beach the first day we met up. And she said to me, oh, yeah, I've decided to do a marathon this year. And that's like one of her goals, you know. And so I said to her, I said, all right, okay, that's, you know, it's going to be hard work. You know, she's got pretty much kind of 10 months to train for it. The Valencia Marathon is really popular. And so I said to her, all right, so I've got, you know, I'll tell you my challenge. And I said, so yeah, I'm only going to eat beef for the next 3 months. And she went, oh, fuck. I said, yeah, you know, I think that's a harder challenge than my marathon, you know. I was like, so I trumped her on her goal. So, but where she's from, they have these things called Terethnos. I don't know if you've ever heard of Terethnos. The Spanish, they love their, you know, they love pork, don't they? Like jamón, they love the jamón and everything, you know. So, but they have these rolls of fat where, you know, like pork scratchings, you know, that we have in England. You must have them where you are, no? And you're in New Zealand, aren't you, Dave? You're in New Zealand? Yeah. So,
I'm in Japan, but I know pork scratchings, yeah.
Okay. So, they have these huge ones that are just rolls of fat that they deep fry in olive oil that when they sit on the table, they're a couple of feet tall and they're famous throughout Spain. So she's been brought up with, you know, lots of different cuts of meat and loads of fat. So she's really cool about it. The only slight problem is that my kind of eating times are quite different to Spanish eating times. So Spanish are very, so they have breakfast, then, you know, they're minimum five times a day eating in Spain, you know, breakfast, and then they have what's called almorzar, which is 10 o'clock, half past 10. They have their bocadillo, which is just like a baguette, you know. Then 2 o'clock is lunch, then 5 o'clock they have what's called merienda. Again, it will be a very carby thing. If it's not bread, it's biscuits or, you know, cakes or something like that. And then dinner, like 9 o'clock, you know, later than that, 10 o'clock at the weekends, half past 10. So that's the only thing, a little bit. It's like, but she's fantastic. So she's so supportive in that sense.
So yeah. Can you see this continuing as a permanent thing?
Yeah, totally. Yeah. I'm just kind of, I did, because I've done the keto, and I did do one summer, I did carnivore, probably for a bit of a dirty carnivore in a way, with lots of chicken and cream and things like that. A much more kind of a loose carnivore, maybe about a year ago, for about 4 or 5 months. It wasn't the same effect that I've had during the lion diet this year. What I'm kind of looking at is to, yeah, definitely do the 3 months of the lion, and then maybe introduce, you know, a few other things like eggs and bacon, a little bit of pork maybe, and things like that, and see how I go, just kind of notice what my body's doing in that respect after the 3 months, and see how that kind of agrees with me or not. I really feel like I'm done with just carbs and sugar, you know, because sugar has given me so much jip the last few years, you know, changes my mood massively, and carbs, just I can just bloat up really, really quickly with carbs. And yeah, I don't see why not. I thought it was going to be a bit more expensive, but now I've settled into this kind of the second month, and I'm eating twice a day. You know, I find kind of try and find some good cheap cuts of beef. I've got a good relationship with my butcher. It's actually no more expensive than what I was eating before. So in that aspect, I don't want to go back to it. I really don't want to go back to pizzas. You know, and you know what it's like. I don't crave those foods anymore. You know, I was, you know, like I say, I was at the restaurant with my family at the weekend, and yeah, you know, they have all the potato dishes, patatas bravas, and you know, all these different foods. And I just sit there and just think, actually, I just have no urge to eat that food at all. You know, and I'll make, you know, I'll still make pizzas. You know, I make pizzas from scratch for my daughter and curries and things like that for my daughter. And yeah, it doesn't affect me at all. So I'm pretty much psychologically over that hump where I feel I just don't need to, I don't want to eat that anymore. I don't feel the need to eat it.
So for someone watching, how long did it take you to get over that hump? For someone watching who's about to get started, how long did it take you to get over that hump where you can just look at the potato dishes or the pizza or whatever and feel like, yeah, I've got no feeling here?
Yeah, I suppose, I mean, for me, that has been a long transition. I would think that it's included from starting fasting to getting into keto, having done and then stopping keto for a little bit and eating, going back to my older habits, and then seeing myself put on a lot more weight and feeling a lot more tired, being much more fatigued in general, and seeing those differences between stopping and starting, and then doing carnivore for just a few months about a year ago, and then going and then jumping off again, and then going keto again. So having done that process for a good couple of years, maybe 2.5-3 years, this time round, when I just decided, so I was doing a bit of kind of meditation and to preempt my kind of date that I gave myself to challenge. So for me this time, it was like, right, I put that date of the 1st of January this year, and that was it. So, but yeah, it has taken me a good, you know, trial and error to get to that this point where I feel really kind of confident about it and just, you know, I'm going to stick to my guns with it. So, and it, you know, it has been a bit of a process of, you know, trying to find out what works with me, what things agree with me and what things don't. You know, when I was doing keto, I was finding that I was waking up, if I was having too many eggs, I was getting arthritis in my fingers. So I'd wake up in the middle of the night and, you know, all I was eating was eggs and a bit of bacon and things like that. And as soon as I cut the eggs out, my hands stopped being painful. You know, I stopped getting these pains that were shooting down my bones. So, yeah, the process has been, you know, a little bit convoluted, I suppose. But this time, you know, I've really gone through the other side, and yeah, I feel much more positive about it. You know, I'm just convinced about it now. So the only problem is, you know, I don't know how it's like for you of going to see any kind of medical practitioner or get any test done. I mean, I loathe to go to my doctor and even talk about it, you know, and it's a bit of a, I'd rather not do it, you know, I'd rather not go to the doctor and see what they've got to say about it, because I know they haven't got a clue, especially not here in Spain, so.
Yeah, generally, I think it's best not to even mention it to the doctors, because it just puts this big roadblock in between you and the doctor, where the doctor can't get past thinking about what you've just said. So every problem that, you know, he may be talking about, or every hypothetical problem in the future, is always going to come back to that thing that you've told him. So it's like, you know.
It's pointless, isn't it? I think.
Yeah.
Unless you're lucky enough to find a doctor who's, you know, very progressive and, you know, is understanding of it. But I'm not sure if any exist in Spain. They're culturally, they're very much fixed into the pharmaceutical way of things here as the health system.
Yeah, it's very similar here in Japan.
And it's a real shame, really. But. you know, and it's just the verbosities that are just trumpeted out all the time of like colon cancer, you know, red meat. It just gets boring, doesn't it? You know, it's just like, come on, have you ever seen the study that was, you know, you're quoting and you don't know why you're quoting it or where you heard that thing to quote, you know? It's just like, do a bit more research.
So, Craig, do you have any social media or anything if people want to reach out to you?
No, not really. I mean, I must admit, I'm a bit stay off social media. I like being a bit of the voyeur more than the someone that you can kind of contact, really. I have kind of thought about it, but I wanted to chat with you and just get a little bit, you know, because I've really enjoyed your chats. I think they're so good. Hearing other people's side of the story, I think it's fantastic that, you know, just to see everyday people's, you know, lives. And, you know, I'd much rather believe people giving their true story about everything, you know, even it, you know, not even just health, you know, alternative side of life, of, you know, the experiences that people have.
Well, I appreciate you coming on and sharing your story with us. Thank you so much, Craig.
My pleasure, Dave. Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, really nice to connect with you and have a chat personally with yourself. Yeah, it's been really good.